Welcome to the Follow Podcast, where we're passionate about helping people go further as they follow Jesus. We believe spiritual growth is an adventure that never ends. So whether you're exploring faith or already a follower, we're so glad you're joining us on this journey. Hey, welcome back to the Follow Podcast. Thanks for joining us. We're here today with Pastor Adam Mesa.
Yes, sir.
Adam Hello. Is a good friend. We've known each other since college. We go way back, and he was actually just at Brave in December, guest speaking, and we didn't get a chance to do a podcast, but he's got me down this weekend, and we're doing a young adults retreat, and so I thought, hey, let's do a podcast. So here we are in his little studio. It only seats how many does this room seat?
About 3,700.
3,700. Yeah. So
it's a little space.
So we're big time now, guys. Follow podcast. We made it. But I just thought it would be a great topic. I've been thinking about what to talk with Adam about. And one of the things that really stands out to me in his ministry is how they use technology to reach people. And so today's podcast is called Leaving the 99 in the Digital Age. There's a passage in Luke 15, verse 4. It says, suppose one of you has 100 sheep and loses one of them. And doesn't he leave the 99 in the open country and go after the lost sheep until he finds it? And I've known just over the years, and we've had so many conversations about ways of reaching people that don't know Jesus or aren't new to faith. I mean, even a podcast, right, is one of those mediums. But I'm really excited. So, Adam, tell us, let's just kick things off a little bit here. Tell us about what are some of the ways that your church is implementing technology to reach people who don't know Jesus?
Well, and I'm sure we'll go more in depth with it, but but you know, some of the there's very practical ways, and then there's very, you know, I would say more creative ways that we're doing it and approaching it. But the way we take it with digital technology for us is how does it work for every generation? So every ministry that we have here, predominantly the family ministries with children's, youth, adult, each one is challenged to reach their generation within the space that they're called to. So like in our children's ministry, one of our pastors, his name's Jeremiah. He has a character called Bob the Bible Guy. And he has a YouTube page that does really well. And they every Sunday they do a 2-minute teaser that looks like a YouTube vlogger. And it's Bob somewhere in the city doing something. And so he's been in Disneyland. He's been in the grocery store talking about the fruits of the Spirit before. He'll come and walk in the middle of service with the adults and ask us, like, you know, Dwayne the Johnson or Kevin Hart, something, something, you know, and he's really connecting to the kids. And then he lands it with biblical truths. And they always show a promo of that in the service. And it points them for the weekly, because so many of our kids, especially, you know, elementary, junior high, I mean, they're living, you know, they're living on this thing. They don't watch TV like that, you know, a Nickelodeon and Disney, they're all trying to keep up with YouTube and all these other things. So we feel it's important in our children's ministry to supply or give some fun content for the kids to watch during the week. So that's been really important for us. And then you go into the, like the youth ministry. And the youth ministry has stuff that would be really youth-oriented. So we use Discord servers, which is really big for, like, kids who game and other things like that. So they our youth pastor, Pastor Heron, he communicates through the Discord server. And we have a gaming ministry called Silverback Squad. And the gaming ministry is basically...
And you're a part of this.
I'm a part of it. Yeah. Because I just... I love hanging out with the youths.
What games are you guys on?
Mostly they'll play Fortnite. But they'll jump... you know, from different games and stuff like that, depending on what it is. But the main game as of right now where a lot of the kids are playing is Fortnite. And they have seen so many kids that come from just dysfunctional homes, bad backgrounds, who love gaming. It's kind of one of their escapes. And, you know, he has rules in gaming with us. Like, you can't, you got to watch your language. You have to, your parents have our cell phone numbers. If you're not acting right at home, you can't play in the squad. There's all these rules to be part of the Silverback squad, but that encourage, you know, that healthy development in that way. And they're also doing stuff like they're enabling the students to, you know, do TikTok and whatever it is that comes out that's popular. It's like, how can we create a safe space and go there? There's stuff, some stuff you just can't go to because it's like, it's just going to be the world and you just stay away from it. And then, but there's other things you can go, well, how can we utilize this just to, you're either going to, you're trying to reach people far from God or the people who are close to God, you're encouraging them that there's a positive viewpoint for this, you know? And so it's like, don't, you know, don't delete your TikTok, but let's think about what positive things we can put on there. And we're encouraging our students in that type of thing. And then you get to the adults and we're doing a lot of stuff like, you know, we've gone the route, we've done podcasts. We stream all of our services online to Facebook, YouTube, and our website simultaneously all at the same time. And we use an app called pray.com and we have 6,000 people in our church in that. And it's just a daily prayer app. And so myself or my dad, who's the senior pastor, he'll write a prayer every morning and then the church just engages with it. And we saw a lot of fruit from that because we encouraged people to download that app and people now can go there for prayer requests. And we've encouraged other people to, you know, share that with someone who needs encouragement. So it's become a great entry-level point for people to church when they have a friend who's going through something. They tell them, hey, our church has this app called pray.com. You should download it and just start putting your prayers in so we can pray for you. And people have been introduced to our church from being invited on the app first, you know. So, yeah, there's a lot of areas that we've taken on digitally that we can try to reach. The other aspect component, too, is we have one other campus, and we're planning on doing multiple campuses, but we do those satellite through technology as well. So this is our broadcast location here, and then they get the sermon. Everything else is live, praise and worship, announcements, all that. But then when it comes to the sermon, now it comes from our preaching team here in Rancho.
One of the things I love just about what you guys are doing is that you're not afraid to jump into any platform, any medium, obviously bringing your values with that, but to meet people where they're already at. And that is leaving the 99. And I just think it's interesting that because technology is always changing and it's always bringing new stuff to the table, there's always something different. Sometimes we can maybe even get some pushback or be afraid to go there. Or just get complacent, you know? And so tell me a little, what's some of the pushback that you guys have gotten when you go into some of these new arenas to reach people?
I mean, you're like, we, you know, we've had that, you know, whether it be YouTube in our children's ministry or whether that be, you know, originally when we started live streaming our services, you know, there was this whole argument like, you can't do that because people will stop coming to church if they can watch you online, you know, like
you're
no one's ever going
to
show up, you know, and it became this whole, it's, you know, a lot of people, treat stuff as either or when it's really actually both and, and, you know, I have this conversation with our, you know, people and team and other people I'm around all the time is, you know, as Christians, we're called to influence culture, not be like the culture. And I think that's where you have to begin to separate things to say, are we doing this because we're trying to be like the culture? In other words, everyone has their own opinion. But, you know, I've always thought it odd that, like, you know, a famous rapper comes out with a cool shirt and then, you know, Christians, they just take the words off of it and they replace it with something Christian, but they copy completely the look and the style. Like, to me, that's where I think, I don't know, I don't want to say, I want to choose my words carefully, but that's where I don't think you're crossing a line. But I think that it's just like, to me, I'm like, well, I don't think as Christians we're called, to me, that's not reaching someone that's far from God. That's just like, that's just being like the world and trying to put your own little Christian spin on it. What I think is influencing, you know, culture is, you know, going and talking to God and talking to other believers and saying, these mediums, these digital technologies, how can we use this to glorify God? How can we use this for people that are far away from God? And so when people give criticisms, first, number one, I listen and I try to process. But my next approach, even in going into these mediums, is not because I want to be like the world. It's I want to influence the world. And if all of our kids are on YouTube or if all of our kids are on TikTok, then I'm going to go there, you know, and I'm going to reach them. And if this next generation is, you know, more digital than ever, then I'm going to think of ways, how can I get to where they're at and how can I use these things that's gonna reach them? So as people will have criticism and critiques for it, sometimes they're valid, but then sometimes it's like, well, we just got to use wisdom for that. You know, I always tell people all the time, like, at some point, someone decided to add an electric guitar in services. At some point. That was in like either the 70s or the 80s. But if you remember that age, if someone, you know, is old enough to remember, when that generation put away the acoustic guitar and they brought out the electric guitar, that there was a whole generation before them that was like, oh my gosh, you're letting Satan in worship. And, you know, Satan has the monopoly on electric instruments. You know, like Satan invented the electric guitar and the bass. And it's like, really? You know, like, and then now, though, you go to any church, even, you know, a church like this or a church like this, everyone's using electric instruments. You know, 6 years ago, it was like, don't go online, blah, blah, blah. Now every church is like, well, we can, if we're not going to do our live services, we can post the sermon afterwards online. And it's like, well, what's the difference, you know?
It's interesting what you said about just that either or thinking that's so easy to fall into when we're unfamiliar with something. It's kind of like what you and I were talking about even just last night, where like when you're talking about something theologically or controversial, and someone just throws in, there's like a red herring, right? And it's the same thing. Unpack that a little bit.
I mean, part of that, you know, when someone's throwing in a red herring, they're...
Explain what that is.
So...
Because I didn't know. I'd never heard this term before.
So red herring essentially is when you're in a discussion with somebody where two people disagree. The one person will use an extreme statement to drive the argument off course. And so... You know, in other words, it's saying like, you know, if you said you like vanilla ice cream, right? And then I interpret it and I say, wow, Pastor Samuel.
You hate chocolate?
I can't believe you hate chocolate. What do you have against chocolate ice cream? You know, it's like, that was a red herring. That had nothing to do with what you were saying. But now if you catch on to that, you'll feel like you have to explain why you like chocolate, but it's not your favorite. Well, you shouldn't even have to go down that path anyway. You never even brought chocolate ice cream up. I did. And people will often do that. Like, you know, you say that, hey, we want to, you know, start offering services online or whatever. And people go, oh my gosh, how you hate gathering of Christians. Why do you're doing away with, you know, the modern church today. And you're like, no, I never said that. My highest priority is for the brethren to gather and hear the word of God. But I also recognize statistics are real, and only people come to church once every 3 weeks.
Last night you told me a story about someone who found Abundant Online. You should share about
that. Past Wednesday, a guy comes in. We do like a 2-minute meet and greet where you get out of your chairs. He walked up to me and he's looking down. He just looks up and he shakes my hand. And then once we make eye contact, it connects. And he goes, I know you. You're one of the people who speak here, right? And I'm like, yeah, I'm one of the pastors. It's nice to meet you. And he goes, today's my first time, but I recognize you because for the past 3 weeks, a friend introduced me to watching you guys on service, your live services.
Wow.
And he goes, you know, I'm just at a point where I really need God. And I finally decided to look up where you guys are located. And I didn't even know you guys were so close to me. So here I am in service, and I've been watching you guys online for weeks. And it's just, you know, he says, great to meet you. And he actually correlated right away. He knew who my dad was. So he said, you know, I've heard your sermon on this. I've heard your dad's sermon on this. And he's speaking to everything online.
Wow.
But he felt like he knew me right away.
Yeah.
And I felt like I knew him right away because he had heard my messages. And we had a common thing we can build off right away. And then at the end of the service, he stands up to give his life to Jesus.
Wow.
And he just came up to me after that. And I prayed with him. And he said, you know, this whole day radically changed my life.
Wow.
Well, his first introduction to us for weeks was all online. He didn't even know what our building looked like. You know, we have people that come to that attend our church digitally that has no idea what size or anything of what our church is. They just believe in the teaching and they go, man, I need this.
They probably see the video and think, your church is smaller than it is, and mine's bigger than it is.
Everyone has their own perception of what it is when you watch online. And I think that's what's great is because it's pure and it's raw. If you're going to watch a sermon and you're going to introduce a friend, there's no other outlying factors other than, you know, our messages. And are these people really preaching the Bible? And, you know, at the end of the day, I would love for everyone to come to church every Sunday. I would love for them to stay after and break bread and fellowship, but the reality is not everyone's doing that.
And there has to be an on-ramp that allows them to get to that place.
Yeah.
And I think that story that you just shared is way more common across churches across America that are willing to go online in that capacity. I heard another story of a guy who actually the same thing, except he decided to follow Jesus like in at home, you know, watching it still, and then signed up to be baptized, and that's when he came to the church. He was supposed to like on the East Coast or something. But
it's my dad the same way. My dad was watching TBN at midnight.
Really?
And there was a guy he was a practicing Catholic, and there's a guy on TV named Arthur Blessett who carries the cross around the world.
Wow.
He gave the gospel, and my dad got saved and watched TBN. TBN was his church for months. And back in that day, this is the 70s, TBN was seen as that platform that was like what people say online today. TBN was like, oh, you're bringing church on TV? People aren't going to go to church anymore if you put church on TV.
Yeah.
And it's like, no, that never happened. But my dad, where he was at, he would have never gone to a church that like we know of now.
Yep.
He would have never stepped foot. If a friend invited him, he would have never gone.
Yep.
But through television, that was his introduction to faith.
Yep.
And then now we look at, look what God has done to our ministry. And it's like that started from our pastor watching TV,
Well, and that's, if you think about it, like anywhere we go physically, because so much we can research so much, even a restaurant.
Yeah.
We're going to look at photos of their food on Yelp before we show
up. Totally. Yeah.
Right. And so if that's a step that we can take, that's actually, again, meeting people where they're at, going to where they are to make them feel more comfortable. I read an article on CNN that talked about, this was like maybe last year, the decline in church attendance, but it was saying that most people, a high percentage of people would show up if they knew they'd feel welcome when they got there.
Right.
And so last month we were having just a meeting, a brunch with our greeting team. Mm-hmm. And someone shared this story of someone they got to greet. And it was this young woman who came for 3 weeks and she just stayed in the parking lot watching to see if the church looked friendly.
Yeah, yeah.
And I'm sure she was online and stuff too, but she just wanted to see. She saw people hugging, she saw people smiling, and then she finally came. And by the time she finally came, like she left with someone for lunch afterwards that Sunday, she was cool. Ready.
Yeah.
But it's interesting just making room for people to come at their pace.
Yeah.
And I think that we're serving people really well when we use technology. So what are some, any more things maybe that have been a little more controversial besides church online or anything? You talked about you guys want to put your gatherings on VR.
So we already have the technology for it. We've done it a few times, so we have it's somewhere oddly in YouTube space, and it's actually really cool. But we have VR technology already here. We just don't do it on a weekly basis yet, because we've actually had it for 5 years. So we just felt like
five years ago
we were doing
that's crazy.
If you look up, like, for our baptisms, it happened 4 years ago when we did baptisms in VR, and it looks really good. And so, I think part of it is, like, staying up to, what I do is staying really close to what's happening in Silicon Valley, what technologies are being created, and seeing how you can get your hands on it to implement. And that's exactly what we did. So we just felt like people weren't ready yet there. Like, we didn't think VR was popular enough now that because it's going to take work at the day. So moving towards technology, it's deciding how much work does it take based off of, how much success is it going to have.
Mm.
And so, like I always tell people, like if you're going to start live streaming your services, start with one platform. Like don't be like, I've talked to people before and they're like, oh, Adam, we're going to do Facebook, YouTube and website like you guys. And I'm like, well, that's very expensive and that's very time consuming. We didn't start with those. We started with...
You're not jumping straight to the hologram,
Right, yeah, it's like take time. So with the same thing with VR, it was that same process of like, how much work is this going to take every week to the capacity of where it's going to be? But I still believe with this next generation, really Gen Z and then eventually Gen Alpha, which is those 4 and under kids, but they're going to, be older, is not just them, but I even look at... senior citizens who are bedridden.
Yeah.
And if we can do VR right, And we've done it before. You can put it here in these seats, wow, mixed around people. And during praise and worship, you can put a headset on and you can look left and right.
Yeah.
And there's people lifting their hands next to you. And, you know, we have so many people in our church that go to the hospital. Mm. We have young people who leave high school and go to college. And so our heart eventually is for every college student, yeah, every high school student that goes off to college, we're going to gift them a VR headset.
Wow.
And say, hey, when you go to school, because that's a big drop-off rate of faith when they go to college.
Yeah.
When you go to college every Sunday, you can still ingrain yourself in your family,
that's an expensive
in your church
care
family,
package,
you know?
Right there.
Yeah. I mean, you can get them relatively affordable and you can find them in China, because all they do is put their phone in it.
So you could buy
like a PC VR headset.
This is not an Oculus for
everybody,
right?
No. We're not going to buy an Oculus, but they could if they wanted to. But no, we'll give them, you know, we'll give them a nice, it's like $25, but you just slide your phone in.
Okay, wow.
And it's incredible, and it's live streamed. So we have the technology. We don't do it every week yet, but
yeah.
You know, that's where people will say, you know, hey, no one's going to come to church anymore. And for us, we don't want to replace church. But this thing with VR is we want senior citizens, people who are in the hospital, and then our young people who are going off to college. We want them to feel like they're still home.
Yeah.
And I think VR will bring that.
I could see that. You know, if you told me that before I'd actually tried it, I might have thought, no, like, it's just because it seems like it would be like blurry or not realistic. Right. You know, like a friend had me over for breakfast last week and he works for Oculus and I tried it on for the first time.
Yeah.
And the first thing obviously I wanted to do is like the Jedi game, right?
Yeah,
like I'm like playing with the lightsabers and stuff. But then he put me in this game called Plank.
Yeah.
And you go up like 40 floors or a skyscraper.
Yeah.
It was so, it felt so real that I laughed because I was so scared.
Yeah.
And I wouldn't walk
realistic.
Out on the plank. Like I was like, but I can only imagine if, like you said, there's people, we got to think outside the box. There's people that literally cannot come.
Yeah.
But they could have a very real experience of a gathering with this technology. That's amazing.
Yeah. I get it. It's not for everyone, but we're
and
like,
it's not
like you just said with the plank, where, I mean, we're going to step out there and that's the thing. We tell people we never want to replace what God really loves, which is fellowship, community, that touch. But we want to have opportunities out there to, like you said, meet people where they're at and introduce them to what that feels like. Because so many people are scared of relationship.
Yep.
And when you hear church, people think, talk to people, say hi, hug. People know me. I'm not comfortable with that. You know, and it's like, so for a season, you know, we encourage just, you know, watching online or whatever. And and then we engage them. Like when we're doing our messages, we're looking at the camera and we talk to the online people. And so every weekend we have on average about 15,000 people watch us now on the weekend.
Wow.
And over the past 3 years, we started with 600 people watching us on the weekend. So we grew from about 3 to 4 years, we grew from 600 people to about 15,000 people. And that was just by being very, very meaningful in how we speak to those individuals. And a lot of people have found Jesus through that.
That's
amazing.
Well, hey, thanks for doing this.
Yeah,
thanks for thanks for tuning in. A couple quick things. Remember to subscribe to this channel if you want regular updates. You can follow Pastor Adam, Abundant Living Family Church, on Instagram or any platform that you're on, because like they're on all of them. So, and then also, if you have questions on this podcast or if there's something that you'd love us to talk about in the future, feel free to comment below and we'll do our best to answer those. We'd love to engage further. We'll see you guys soon.
Thank you.
Thanks for joining us on the Follow Podcast. Wherever you may be on your faith journey, remember that following Jesus was never meant to be done alone.